Our life journey is also like this. We don't know how to find our way. We are traveling and we are seeking. The seeking is the force which drives us sometimes crazy. We don't know what to do. We have to seek something. We are not satisfied with what we have. So we go on seeking. Now what are we seeking? We have no idea as to what we have to seek. A thing that will give us satisfaction. The place which will stop our journey. Our abode where we would rest. Earth within us is very evident in the modern time. It was never so much. This is the first time you find so many people are seeking. And they are genuinely seeking. They feel that there is something lurking in their being. There is something that is missing. Being said in the scriptures, in all the scriptures, whether Indian, Islamic, or biblical, that to be there, you are to be born again. In Gita, Sri Krishna says, those who see, can see. Those who cannot see, cannot see. Ya sa pashyati, sa pashyati. The one who cannot see, is a simple thing. But to a normal human being, he can't understand that I can see everything, why can't I see? I see the color, I see the room, I see everything. Now why it's said that those who can see, and those who cannot see? It's a very mysterious statement. Supposing I say that in these petals there are lots of cells and it's divided into many cells. Then you'll say, no, we see them. There are only petals. We don't see any cells. So, you require a microscope. You have to make a section of that. And under the microscope you can see there are cells. You can see the cells clearly under the microscope. All that is material, you can see with your material eyes. But there is something else about which these people are talking, that you have to see it through your spirit. It gets satisfied by itself. Atmane vatmane tushta. The spirit gets satisfied by itself. These saying sound extremely mysterious to us. But if I say this room is dark, come inside and you can see. But you come inside, you find it still dark, you can't see it. So somebody puts on the light and you see everything. This is also outside us, putting the light, microscope. This is paroksha, is the outside, by which your material eyes can be projected more. You can see more. But if I say you have to see inside, you can't turn your eyes back to see inside. That you cannot do. Now what is the method by which you can see inside, or feel inside, or go inside? Through our eyes, our attention goes out, we see everything. But supposing tomorrow something topples down, immediately our attention is attracted towards that happening. So inside us, there must be some arrangement, some happening that must be attracting our attention inside, and that's how we must be going inside. We have evolved from amoeba to this stage. We are human beings. Our evolution has come through our attention fixed outside. The happening has to go inside. But the evolution so far has been by going outside. Like some fishes fell the land and tried to crawl out, and they became the reptiles. The reptiles wanted to run fast, so they developed four legs as a tortoise. As animals, they could not eat, so they raised their heads. Things at the height they could not see, so they raised their body more. So all the evolution so far has come through the urge of seeking only, but it has been outside. We have been seeking food. As human beings, we have seeking power, we have been seeking money, possessions, comfort. But now the seeking has to go within. For example, when we are building a house, we build all the outside and everything properly. When it is all done outside, then you go inside and start decorating. In the same way, you have to go inside to achieve the last breakthrough. For example, we have made a fortress for ourselves, and we have to enter inside the fortress to enjoy it. We have to penetrate inside the house to enjoy it. But our attention is outside. We cannot go inside. So something has to happen that you are to be sucked in. Some sort of a vacuum is created inside by which you are sucked in. It's a beautiful arrangement which has been sahaja, means spontaneously growing within us. Like a seed has all the maps of the tree it has to become. It does not have to consult A to Z or anything. It has its own map, and it grows on that map spontaneously. In the same way, our being has been growing spontaneously since we were just matter, lifeless matter. Gradually it was sprouting, and we reached the stage where today we are human beings. But that's not the end, because if it was, we would have known our meaning. We would have known why we are here. Now, the happening takes place through the awakening of this kundalini. It is placed in the triangular bowl. It is there. You can see with your naked eyes, it is there. We are here to tell you the message that now, this last evolutionary process which has to take place has started. Like every instrument has to be prepared first of all and put to the mains so the electricity starts flowing through it and starts manifesting. In the same way, your instrument has been created so beautifully and the electricity that they call as the divine power of love of God has to flow through. To connect you to that power, very beautifully, God Almighty has placed this energy of Kundalini in your triangular bowl. I say, this is the power of divine love. There are so many powers we know of. Of course, apart from the material powers we have. We know that there are people who are indulging into all kinds of subconscious powers, into all kinds of supraconscious power, because a person can just make these flowers gather together, sitting down here. A person can just break this with one hand. But do you get anything out of that? If it is your living process of germination, do you get any transformation out of it? Supposing somebody breaks this, so what? We can otherwise also break it. If you put it to some electrical saw, you can break it. If somebody is sitting down here, collects the flower, so what? If anybody has any such powers, they are all outside powers. The electricity has to flow inside. So to have your own power, you individually have to be connected to the main. What's the use of seeing somebody else's powers also? Best thing is you are your own guru and you have your own powers. For example, when this thing is not lighted, it looks as if it has no power. But as soon as it is lighted, you find this light coming in. It can burn. Not only it can give you light, but it can burn. It can melt. It has all the powers of fire as soon as it is unlocked. Potentially it had all the powers, but it was not aware of it. In the same way, whatever potential powers you have got, we have to tap them. These powers reside within us, still unenlightened. As soon as they are enlightened, you become aware of your powers. First, we must know what we have before distributing something to others. For example, you are a bankrupt and you start, oh, I am a very generous man. What's the use of such a generosity when you have no money in the bank? Are you going to distribute your debts? We must know what do we have in our bank. We must find out if we have any powers with it. If we have, then we can distribute. Now I say we have lots and lots of power. We are really very powerful. And also I say that these powers are to be enlightened within you so that they manifest, so that you feel your power. So that you can maneuver your power, so that you can know that this power of love is the supreme, is the highest. Like if you are made a king tomorrow, you will feel very happy about it. With that happiness, you will also have powers to rule, powers to punish. When you get these powers of your spirit, then you become the citizen of the kingdom of God Almighty, who is all-powerful. And He is a very, very compassionate Father. He is compassion. He is ocean of compassion. He is ocean of love. He is ocean of mercy. And He wants to give all these powers to you so that you are empowered. To manifest your being. When you get these powers also, you feel absolutely enamored. You feel absolutely quiet. Now you found it. As we came here, going round Northampton for 45 minutes, as soon as we saw the name of the builder, we said, "You've got it." But the difference is that we knew the name of the building. Here you don't know anything. But the proof of the pudding is in the eating of it. In the same way, you come to a point where you know, "I found it. I've got it." At that point, you have to achieve yourself. You have to certify yourself. Nobody else can certify. Even those people who get the Kundalini awakening, and also the piercing of the fontanel bone in the beginning, start thinking, because thinking is a disease of the Western mind. They think about everything, even about which they cannot think. This happening takes place without thinking. They start thinking, "Is that the one we have caught it?" Then again you come down to the thinking level. Like, supposing we come to this place and then we go back to see, is that the place we have to go? So you are still sitting outside. Now you have found it. Now just verify if it's so or not. Get inside it. Get inside it. Try to find out. Yes, we saw somebody. Yes, this is it, this is it. Here it is we have to be. Of course, there are scriptures who have said that when you achieve your self-realization, then you become collectively conscious, samuhika chetana. You become. But it is a term which is very difficult to grasp before you are realized. Means what happens? What is collective consciousness? What happens to us is that you start feeling yourself and others on your fingertips, 5, 6, and 7 centers. Doctors have reached a conclusion that these are the endings of the sympathetic nervous system. But they do not know the decoding of it, they do not know how they are, how they work out, what is their work. Like now at the end of it, you have got these tips. When the enlightenment takes place, you get them on the tips, you don't enlighten them there. These centers get enlightened, the light comes in. Now what is a light in awareness is sensitive. Supposing this finger is numb, say in leprosy you must have known that the fingers become absolutely numb. When the fingers are numb, then you cannot feel anything. When the enlightenment takes place, then the numbness goes away and you start feeling it. But when realization takes place, then these fingers become even more alert, much more alert. and you start feeling something funny. Like today one girl came to my house and she said, "What's happening to me? My fingers are tingling." Just as you would go near this, you feel hot. Everyone will feel hot. This is subjective. Nobody is going to say that I'm feeling cool. But you, when you are realized, you start feeling cool from here. You'll be amazed. Even from the light, you get the cool. You see, I put my hand here. There's no breeze over here. They have started moving. There's no breeze. Suddenly when I put my hand, they start moving. You start feeling the breeze going through you. This is the breeze of the Holy Ghost. This is the Chaitanya Lahari described by Shankaracharya. Shankaracharya preached Advaita, means we are like small drops separated from the ocean. And when we go back to the ocean, we become the ocean. The powers of the oceans come into us. This is the Advaita of Shankara. That means you become powerful as the ocean is. And this is what happens, that a small cell, which is now acting according to the dictates of the brain, becomes aware of the brain and can communicate with the brain. Or we can say a small cell becomes aware of the whole. You become aware of the powers of Almighty. Not only aware, but you know how to handle it. You know how to make it flow through you. You know that there are problems in your being, but because of that it's not flowing properly. You know how to correct it yourself and you know how to correct it in other people. This is the samadhi, is the enlightened awareness. This is what should happen to you, by which your powers start manifesting and giving light to others. You are to be enlightened so that you enlighten other people. This is the thing we have to ask for. Before this, all the things what people do has no meaning. You are not connected to the phone, whom are you dialing? There are people who say, "Oh, we believe in God, we believe in Divine, we are singing of Him." You are not connected. Krishna has said it, that yoga kshema vahamyam. First you must have yoga, that is realization. Then kshema means then well-being you look after. Like some people you must have seen on Oxford Street, with those hairstyles, dancing with the dhotis and Hare Rama, Hare Krishna, like mad. What are they doing? They have no connection with God. Supposing I have to meet the Queen, and I have no connection with her. And I stand on Oxford Street and start just thinking, "Queen Elizabeth, Queen Elizabeth." The police will catch hold of me and put me in the lunatic asylum. You have no authority, you have no connection, you have no protocol. How are you connected? How are you asking for anything? This is the truth, that you have to become a hollow machine through which this divine love has to flow. If you do not get it today, you will come to me tomorrow. There are people, I met the other day, interesting people. Sometimes I really laugh. If there is a fake person who is showing such miracles like lifting these flowers, there will be thousands of people to go and see the show. If there is somebody who is saying that I will give you a mantra? People are so mystified, they do not know what to expect. They go to him, pay money, and thousands will be there just to pay money, and he tells in your ear a funny mantra. Now the other day there was one guru who has given a mantra, he doesn't know a word of Sanskrit, called as Tinga. Tinga means this, you see, show like this to someone, in Hindi language it means Tinga. It's not even Sanskrit. He's given that mantra to someone. Just what do you say to that? He's befooling people like this, taking money from them, and people are involved. Now what are you seeking? Are you seeking a mantra? He says that by saying these mantras, you can fly. You should ask the gentleman to fly himself, first of all. Take him to the seventh story, drop him from there, and see how far he goes flying. It's a simple thing. And then we should know, are we to fly now like birds? Have we to become now birds, flying in the air? Why are we seeking such nonsensical things? What's wrong with us? Are we stupid people? What's gone wrong? How can we seek these things? What are we seeking? We are seeking ourselves. Ourselves, our spirit. Everyone has said this, that you are to be reborn. Like an egg is born first. We are really like an egg. We don't know anything outside. Just like an egg, you see, that yellow stuff called as ego and the blue stuff, deep blue stuff, sometimes even black it could be, called as superego, they just make you an egg. You are lost in yourself. You are separate. An egg cannot fly, cannot see anything. It matures by itself. It has to be an egg. It matures by itself, spontaneously. And when the time comes, the mother bird pierces the head of the egg. And here comes the bird. It's a miracle, but the bird is already there, ready. In the same way, your rebirth takes place. In Sanskrit language, a bird is called a dvijaha and a Brahmin is called a dvijaha. But these days the word Brahmin means nonsense. Brahmin means the one who has known the Brahma. Brahma is the divine power of love of God. It's just love. Love is knowledge. And love is joy. When the whole being, the attention of a being is filled with this love, you just become the joy. You just throb with joy. And every throbbing of yours is love. And that love gives you the knowledge of others. If you purely love somebody, even otherwise, then you know everything about that person. In the BBC, sometimes you see those husband-wife games, very interesting. What hair oil does she use? What kind of motorbike she likes? Such questions are asked, just to judge the knowledge of the husband and wife among them, to find out. Because if they love each other, they will know all these small, small things. But when it is pure love, you just know it becomes subjective, absolutely subjective, because you become the subject of love. So you know everything about everyone, and everything is known through its essence. Now see, this fire is here, all right? To you, this is ordinary fire. I can enlighten this fire. Doubly. If I enlighten this, then this fire can burn away all the impurities. You know, it does. You know this, Madaras. I was in Kuala Lumpur, and the speaker of the assembly, or a Muslim, invited me to his house. And there were about 1,000 people who had come. I think out of which at least 300 were sick. The rest have come to help them out. And they all gathered in a big garden, very big garden. I had no other Sahaja Yogis with me, I was just alone. I said, it's all right, you all sit on the ground. I just requested the Mother Earth, now take away the problem. And she started sucking. There was a boy who had polio trouble. They had brought him, she just brought him, kept him there. He could not walk at all. He was brought like a cake and put on the ground. Suddenly the mother said, where is the boy gone? He had just got up and walked out. You can ask the Mother Earth. You can ask the fire, because you are connected. You are at the essence of it. What is the essence of Mother Earth? Can any one of the scientists tell you? Any Sahaja Yogi? What is the casual essence of Mother Earth? Fragrance. Fragrance is the casual essence of Mother Earth. And fragrance has the capacity of magnetism. And that's why the Mother Earth has got the magnet. It is most surprising. That's why people wear, you see, all these beautiful fragrances to attract others or to soothe others. So fragrance of the Mother Earth, if you can enlighten, even while Kundalini is rising, within you is the Mother Earth also, the element of Mother Earth. Where is it? In the lowest, that lowest chakra, there is the Mother Earth. It's made from the Prithvi Tattva, from the Mother Earth, the essence of the Mother Earth. Suddenly you start getting lot of fragrance in you. And you don't know from where this fragrance is coming. And you find that it is this center which is being enlightened, and you are getting fragrance. Then the second center which you see there is the center which comes from fire and Mother Earth. The essence of that is fire and Mother. So we can use fire to cure that. For example, when you think too much, the center revolves around you too. By thinking too much, the center has to work very hard, because it replaces your brain cells through the fat cells which are here. It transforms them and sends them for the brain cells. It has to work very hard, and when it works very hard, then all its working hard works on the center called as the Agya, especially on the back side, when it is obstructed. When it's working as obstructed, all that effort goes back here. When it goes back there, then it affects your eyes. Can you imagine? If you can somehow or other manage to enlighten the sun, you can get rid of your eye trouble. Your eyes can be cured through treatment from the sun, but you have to be a realizer. You can manage the sun all right. The third center that is there is the center made out of water element. Now water has a capacity to flow. It has a capacity to cleanse. It has many capacities. It is shine. This center gives you the shine on the face. Kanti rupena sanskrita, kanti. Now if this center is allowed to flow properly, properly is the word, if you allow this center to absolutely go wherever it lies, your attention will be frittered. But if you use it properly and allow it to grow within you, your living process, because you know by water only living things live, then you reach a stage where you can even enlighten this center. And when you enlighten this center, the first thing that happens to you is that your material problems get solved. It's a very deep science. Many people who have come to me had no job, they were in complete shambles, as they say, all in a mess, had no money, didn't know what to do. This center got enlightened and they got the essence, and the essence is called as Lakshmi Tattva. They got job, everything was helped, they had a nice house. People who had no houses, who were living in very small little houses, but good houses, they don't know how they managed it and how they got it, how this miracle took place, because the essence within you of your well-being in this center is enlightened. If the second center is enlightened, then you become suddenly very creative. It's the center of thinking. Then you don't think. Thinking makes you mad. For example, have you seen a writer writing something? He'll have file of papers torn out. He's writing something. And you find he cannot do it. He'll go mad. Again he'll write something. But see, it's not all right. Then he puts it down. But when you are realized and that center is enlightened, you don't have to sit down and think. It just comes out. You write it down. Because the essence of the center is creativity. It comes from within. By thinking, you cannot bring out your creativity. You cannot. Only thing is that if you have the technique, the creativity comes from within and through the technique you express. Musicians, poets, artists. I've known people who never knew how to sing, had horrible voices, now are melodiously singing like a cuckoo bird after realizing. Of course, that is also another center which is here when this one is enlightened. Now, every center I cannot tell today because it's a long, big thing. But I just have to tell you that when these centers are enlightened, your powers of these centers start manifesting. Secondly, all these centers become integrated. You don't have a problem to integrate yourself. For example, some people are working here. Their mind is somewhere else. They don't want to do it. They just don't want to do that work with their force to be there. The mind is somewhere else. They are thinking of something else and asking for something else. So they are divided among them. They don't know whether to do it or not do it. But when you get this realization, all your body, mind, everything gets integrated. And whatever you do, creates joy. Now this is all too fantastic for me. I know it is too much, much too much for first. But why I have given you this? Is because I've seen yesterday I was little disappointed the way people are frivolous. The way people do not have any self-esteem. They are very egotistical. Egotistical persons are stupid, always stupid. Egotistical. You must have seen how an egotistical person talks. Like a stupid fool, he doesn't understand. And they are so frivolous also. They have no self-esteem. They don't understand what they have to see, what they have got. That's why I'm telling you today that you should know that it's the most important thing. It's the only thing that you have to achieve. Do not go in for useless miracles. Ask for the miracle of your strength. when the spirit manifests, be amazed how beautiful you feel and how beautifully you work it out, because you have found out your whole. You have found out your destiny. You have reached your goal. I hope it will work with those who are here. I know there are few, and people might think that very few people have come, but it is a living process. For reality, even to get so many people is, I think, is great. At the time of Christ, all his life, he could gather 12 fishermen. How could you talk about Kundalini to 12 fishermen? But to get even this set of people for reality, I'm very happy about it. By God's grace, gradually this living process will be accepted and people will take to reality and not to these circuses. We have to get the real within us. We have to know ourselves fully. This has to happen. If it does not happen in you, it doesn't mean it's wrong with the system, there's something wrong within, which can be corrected. It should happen in second sitting or the third sitting. I'm here to work it out, and we all have to work it out. It's a very long thing, which I do not want to say now, but there are so many lectures I've given, you can go through and see for yourself. Here in Northampton, we have a very great Sergio winning. It's Maria and her husband, Izu. That is a very great Sergio. So this has a special place in all the way. When I came here first, we had lots of these black magic people, occultists coming. They all started dancing, doing this, that, and I said, now where am I here? But today I find the people are of a different style, a different nature. And it is for such people, for people of that caliber, who are seeking the reality. May God bless you.